Shalom, Mishpocha. Shalom, family. Mishpocha is a Hebrew word. It means family. And we're the Mishpocha, the family with a Jewish heart, made up of Jewish and non-Jewish people that are one new man in Messiah Yeshua, Messiah Jesus, getting ready, Mishpocha, to blow the grandest shofar, the grandest trumpet in Zion. We want everyone everywhere to hear the good news. We want everyone everywhere to be red hot for the Messiah. And when I say red hot, I am actually thinking about my guest who happens to be in the studio. She is from Rwanda. She is currently living in the United States, Denver, Colorado. Her name is Christine Wizera, and Christine is a survivor of the Holocaust. And when I'm saying the Holocaust, I'm not talking about the Holocaust against Jewish people, as you might think, but I'm talking about the Rwanda Holocaust. And Christine, you were how old when this horrible tribal war erupted in your country?
Yes, I was 22 years old. I was going to Rwanda University, so I was 22 years.
And you were on your way to visit your sister and her husband.
Yes.
Tell me about that.
Yes, it was during Easter break, and I decided to go see my sister who was pregnant, who had just given a baby. The baby was 4 months old. And so when I was there, it was April 6th. Rwanda is going through terrible time. There is a war which has been happening from the year 1990. Mm-hmm. In April, I decided...
Listen, for those that aren't familiar, when I say Holocaust, I mean it. In a 3-month period,
yes.
1 million people were murdered?
Yes, that's correct.
It's, you know, we here in the United States, we watch television. By the time we're 18, I forgot what the statistic is, but we've seen thousands and thousands of murders before our very eyes, and we're almost like numb. And when we hear a million people murdered in a 3-month period, it's hard to comprehend. It has to be one of the most horrible experiences of your life.
It was. And I was very young, and I didn't have hope in Jesus Christ. So I went to visit my sister, and when I was there, all of a sudden, in me, I felt I can't spend the night. I don't know what it was, but I told her, listen, I can't stay. I have been here for a few hours. I'm going to the countryside. I will see you in a couple weeks. And so when I left, after six hours, I would never see my sister again. She was killed during the genocide. Her husband, her baby of 4 months, and then her 2 maids who were working for her.
Now, out of curiosity, were murders done with guns, or were they done with machetes? Or
now, these murders were done by people using traditional weapons. What I mean by that is like knives, machetes. So it was killing one and one most of the time. So you could easily find somebody who killed 50 people using a knife.
So when you realized you were in the middle of a war, and not just a normal type war, how in the world did you survive? And you weren't even a real Christian.
No, I was not. And I didn't have hope. That was the hard thing to do. But you see, the love of God never fails. God loves even a sinner. And even those who are listening now, if you don't know God, please know that He loves you, but He doesn't want you to stay in that condition. He wants you to come so that you will experience His love. So I left my sister and went to the countryside, and the killings started in the city where my sister was living. It didn't go to the countryside, and my life was spared in this way. To this moment, I keep asking God, why me? Why did you save me? Because you see, if I didn't live, my life would have died. And so to this day, I'm very thankful for every day I'm alive.
Now, here's the thing that is so amazing, Christine. You go from a Holocaust, literally.
Yes.
I mean, you're a young person, even now, but you survived the Rwanda Holocaust. You then flee and go to the Congo, and you walk into another war.
Yes, when I went to the Congo, it was a very difficult situation because when I fled the war, I left my family behind. We were 10 children. I go by myself. I don't know anybody. I don't speak much of the language they speak in the other country. And it was my first experience out of the country. When I went there, it was really hard situation, but I saw the hand of God. The Bible says that God takes care of the birds of the air. He knows even when a sparrow fall to the ground. So I saw how God took care of our lives. I was by myself. I didn't know where my family was. And I stayed into the Congo for 2 years.
I don't even know how you could have survived that. And you go to a foreign country. You're by yourself. I assume you did you have any money?
No, I didn't have any money.
And you really didn't. You really did not know God, but he knew you.
Yes.
But... even that must have been a horrific experience.
Yes,
for you.
It was. But every time you see, Sid, I was born in a Catholic family. I knew God a little bit, and always I had a very small Gideon Bible. And during the middle of the war, because there are many times I will be in a building where everybody is killed by me, and then every time I took that Bible.
Wait a second. You say you were in a building where everyone was killed?
But me, yes. Like they would throw a bomb and
yes.
Many people will die and I will be able to flee myself from it. But it was God doing that for me. And there are many times also where I would be sitting with other people and they will be taken out of the car, killed by me. So God spared my life. But every time I would say, God, please, if you save me from this war, I will serve you. I will come to know you. But every time my life would be spared, I would not turn back to God. I didn't know who God was for real.
Okay, so you survive the Rwanda Holocaust in a very supernatural fashion.
Yes.
You survive the war going on in the Congo.
Yes.
Why did you then decide to go back to Rwanda?
Now, there was another war which happened in Congo, and it was also a terrible war. They were trying to kill some people who look a certain way. And so when I saw the same war happening, the same war I left back to Rwanda, I said, there is nowhere to flee. I'm going back to my land, so I die on my own soil. But everything you see, Sid, was the plan of God, because God had planned that my daughter Christine is going to be saved. On this date.
Christine, so you're saying to me, you went back home,
yes,
Rwanda, you're an orphan, some of your brothers and sisters are dead, you're going back there to die, and the moment your foot touched Rwanda soil,
yes.
What happened?
Now, let me say something. After the genocide, the power of God came upon Rwanda in a mighty, mighty, mighty way that you could feel it in the air. So here I come from Congo. I get to the border. The moment my foot stepped into the border, I started shaking, 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 shaking from inside out. I started hearing the voice which says, God is mighty. God is great. I mean, this voice, I knew it was the Holy Spirit. Nobody told me it was the Holy Spirit. But you know, when God visits you, you get knowledge. You understand. You know it is God. And so this voice shook me and stayed inside me for a whole month until I was led to a born-again Christian church.
And is that where you got really born again?
That's where I gave my life to Jesus publicly. But to be honest with you, from the first moment I heard that voice, I knew God was real and I knew I needed to run to him. And I knew that a new beginning is going to start for me.
But how old were you at that time?
When the shaking started happening, I was 24, going almost 25.
And you already had lived a lifetime with
yes.
all that you went
yes.
through.
Yes, I had seen death.
You were going there to die. You were going back to Rwanda to die, and you bump into a revival, and it's so strong, the minute your feet touch the ground, you started shaking.
Yes, I started shaking, and the people had all changed, become a Christian, because we saw the face of evil. We saw how the enemy has come to kill, steal, and destroy, and many people saw the power of God. The same power was everywhere. Many people turned to God. You could see it on their face. Even the way we greet each other in Rwanda, it has changed. We greet each other in this way. Yesu Ashime, which means praise the name of Jesus. That's how we greet each other.
Now, the thing that intrigued me about you is, for a young person, having survived such two major wars, and you should not have survived, you know it was God.
I would have died.
I know it was God. And you survived these wars. You go back to your home country, but you had an encounter with what most people just read about in the Bible. The Bible talks about being baptized in the Holy Spirit and in fire.
Yes.
And in this country, we're moving more towards seeker-sensitive type churches than this. Shalom, Mishpacha. Shalom, family. Mishpacha, it's a Hebrew word. It means family. And we're the Mishpacha, the family with a Jewish heart, made up of Jewish and non-Jewish people. The middle wall of separation has come down. The ancient Jewish anointing is merged with the new covenant Christian anointing to form what Paul calls one new man. And when these two anointings come together, we have the glory that God originally intended for the congregation. I have a woman in my studio. Her name is Christine Wizera, and Christine is from Rwanda. She's a survivor of the Rwanda Holocaust in a three-month period from 1990 to 94. The war went on, but in a three-month period, 1 million people were murdered. It's a Holocaust. She survived. She was not a Christian. She should not have survived. Time and again, bombs would go off, and everyone would die except her. She was in a place where her own family was murdered, and she wasn't even a Christian, and she knew she had to leave. Had she stayed there, she would have been dead too. She says even today, "Why me, God? Why did you spare me?" And a million of my people and my own family were murdered. So she left Rwanda. She wanted a little peace, and she goes to another African country, Congo. And she doesn't speak the language. She has no money. She's a young person. I mean, she stood no chance. And again, God's hand spared her life because she walked into another war. And then she decided, well, I'm just going to see my family and die. I'm going to go back to Rwanda. And she, the minute her foot touched the ground in her home country, she didn't know it, but a revival had happened. The whole country had changed, and she started shaking with the Holy Spirit. And she found herself going to a born-again church. She got saved. And tell me about the time the fire of God came on you.
Yes, after I got saved in the revival of Rwanda, many people, God spoke prophecy to us that He is sending us all over the world to take this fire. For me, I was sent to United States, where God told me, "You know why you are coming here. I have set you apart." So I came in United States in 97, but when I came, even though supernaturally God granted me to go to school, I was not like anybody else. I knew why I came. So I was a new Christian, but God took me through a time of sanctification and seeking. I sought God for what appeared to be 7 years, and in 2004, we had the Rwanda revival here in the United States, and that's when I was ordained. During that time, the fire of God came upon me, and my life has never, never again been the same. Today, I walk in signs and wonders, and I feel the shaking. I feel the fire of God. The voice of God has become so clear that we are living the last day, that only the people who have this fire will be able to change this world, this United States, and all over the world. So that happened in 2004, when a man of God came from Rwanda to ordain me in a revival meeting in Ohio.
Tell me, because we hear the word fire. Mm-hmm. I understand. I've been to revival meetings in Toronto, Pensacola. I've seen people shake under the power of God. What is the fire of God? What did you experience? I know that this is hard to explain in human language, but explain to me, Christine. What is this fire? What did it do to you? What does it feel like?
This is what the fire of God is. The Bible talks about God as a God who is a consuming fire. If you read the Bible in the book of Daniel, it talks about God whose throne is ablaze with flames of fire. And it talks also the river of fire even flowing before the throne of God. Now, when you seek God, you seek, you keep seeking, you get to where you and God become one. When you become one with God, His fire comes all over you. Why do you need this fire? This fire you need because without fire, there is no passion. You cannot serve God in your own strength. And some people just get baptized with the Holy Spirit. They speak in tongues. That's it. But God wants to tell you today, speak in a tongue. Yes, receive the Holy Spirit. But don't stop there, because the Bible says that when He comes, that Jesus Christ, He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and the fire. The fire of God is the power of God that comes upon you, and it purifies you. It's the power which stays from morning to evening. Your mind cannot but think about Jesus Christ when you receive the fire of God.
Christine, you said something that's very important. There are many that have had an encounter with God. They might even call it the fire of God, the presence of God, but then it lifts. It's just
yes.
From time to time. Are you saying that we can, could, and should walk in His presence 24 hours a day, 7 days a week?
Yes, that's what happened to me. From the year 2000, the time I got baptized with the Holy Spirit, my heart is always thinking about God. My heart is always crying out, God, I love you. There is no moment that my mind shifts from thinking about God. And at the same time, I do His work, but my heart is always with God. You see, sometimes Christian, we get used to the Christian life, and so we start making quick visitation to the Lord. But God
because we're so busy.
Yes, we are so busy. And we come, we give God 5-10 minutes. But if you read the book of John, it talks, abide in me. I have tried before I got baptized in the fire to abide in Christ. But I will go there, but a few minutes, my mind is out. But after I got baptized in the Holy Spirit and the Holy Fire, because this is a fire which purifies you. And so you walk by the Spirit, not in the flesh. And so you're able to abide in the presence of God, because the flesh and the blood will not abide in His presence. But the man who walks by the Spirit, he will stay in the presence of God.
Now, I know God has given you dreams and visions of things that have happened in the past, and we'll get into that later.
Yes.
Later on. But has God given you any indication prophetically as to what is going to happen in the United States of America?
Yes.
What have you seen?
Many times I have dreams and visions. I can't say that I understand all of them. Sometimes I say I don't understand until later. But one thing God has shown me, He opened my eyes to where I saw His angels pouring the fire upon the earth. There is a big revival coming. But you, people of God, understand this. It's not possible to receive the fire of God when you live in the flesh. If you want the fire of God, pray and pray and purify yourself, then you will be able to receive the fire. When you receive the fire, you will be a channel through which God will work and touch his people. There is a big revival coming upon the earth, and that's why God wants to separate us from the world, from the things of this world, so that we can walk in the power. There is a big revival coming to United States of America and all over the states, but before this happens also, we will see much of evil. There is so much evil happening.
Have you seen what is going to happen in a bad way, in a judgment way, in the United States of America?
Yes. United States of America, things are not going to get better as far as evil is concerned. The enemy is planning, inventing new things to come against the continent of United States. There is a possible, I have seen in my dreams, many bombs falling under the continent of the United States. Last week, I saw even in United States a war happening and they were using ground forces.
You know, Christine, I think that those Christians that do not experience God's presence 24/7, do not experience his fire, they're going to forget they're Christians when things get really bad in America. Why this book? Why now? Why did you just write this book, Christine?
Yes.
What's the purpose?
When I came to United States of America, God had told me I will write a book, but he told me to wait on him. I finished college, I make good money, so I said, this is a good time to write. He said, no. And then there was a time of seeking God for 8 months where I was not working. All I did was pray all day long. And then at night, wait on the Lord. And during one of those months, the Lord told me, it's time to write the book. When he said write, I protested. I said, no. I don't have any money. I don't have any money. I'm not working. But God says, it's my book. I'm going to make it available. And so I went ahead and wrote. I didn't know why, but when I was in the middle of almost finishing it, the Lord said, the message of fire has to go out because my people are hungry. Some of my people are confused. When they see this message of fire, they are going to be more thirsty, more hungry for me, and they will want to know what is it about the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the Holy Fire.
Now you talk about... in your book and in my notes here, you talk about sometimes you'll pray all night long.
Yes.
Most American Christians could not do that. Why? Do you find it difficult?
The first time when I saw so much evil happening in the United States, I saw people doing witchcraft openly and nobody's doing something. I said, Lord, I need to do something. The Lord told me, then you need to seek me more. You need my power. And I started praying. The first time I would pray 20 minutes, it's very hard. But then every single day I persevered. I endured. I would go, if I did 20 minutes, the next day I would do 25. And I kept enduring. It got to a point where I can't help it. I just love it. What I can't afford is the time. Sometimes I don't have time.
So what you said is you passed a realm where it's something that you desire.
Yes.
Rather than
yes.
you force yourself to
yes,
do it.
Yes, to where now any free time I have, it is about seeking the Lord. There is no time to lose. If you people in America, you could see how Satanists are serving Satan, the devil, that they are fasting for the church to be destroyed. They are fasting for the pastor to be destroyed.
In other words, what she's saying is the devil's people are seeking the devil. Shouldn't God's people be seeking him even more?
Yes.
You need a fire. You need this book, The Blazing Holy Fire, for a donation of $18. Get it now. If you would like to receive a complimentary copy of our bi-monthly teaching newsletter, materials catalog, or information about becoming Mishpucha or Chalitzim, write to me, Sid Roth, Post Office Box 1918, Brunswick, Georgia, 31521, or call our order-only line, 1-800-548-1918. To place a credit card order, call anytime, 1-800-548-1918.
1918. For all other calls, the number is 912-265-2500. That's 912-265-2500.
For a cassette tape, or CD, of this week's broadcast,
send a donation of $10 or more to Sid Roth, that's S-I-D-R-O-T-H, Post Office Box 1918, Brunswick, Georgia, 31521. To see our television show, It's Supernatural,
or archives of our radio and TV shows,
look us up on the web at www.sidroth.org. That's www.sidroth.org.
Shalom, Mishpucha. Shalom, family. Mishpucha, it's a Hebrew word. It means family. And we're the Mishpucha, the family with a Jewish heart, made up of Jewish and non-Jewish people. That middle wall of separation has come down, and the Jewish anointing is merging with the New Covenant Christian anointing, not in an ecumenical way. That's nice. It's better than not. But I mean in a spirit way, where the ancient Jewish anointing literally merges with the New Covenant Christian anointing, and we become one new man. Jesus put it this way. He said, I pray that they, meaning Jews and Gentiles in John 17:21, I pray that they, Jews and Gentiles, might become one. What will happen? So that the world will believe. And the same glory that is on me, Jesus says, the same glory that is on Jesus is going to be on them. Now, in preparation for this great move of God, you, if you're from a non-Jewish background, must move in signs and wonders. Why? Because Romans 11:11 says salvation has come to the Gentile to provoke the Jew to jealousy. When we have diseases that medical science doesn't have answers for, when we have problems coming to America that money can't buy your way out of it, the only solution will be people that know God. Now, the Bible talks about the baptism in the Holy Spirit and in fire. And in America, we know we've had the Pentecostal movement, the charismatic movement. But I have in my studio now Christine Wizera. Christine is a survivor of the Rwanda Holocaust, and she received what the New Covenant calls the baptism in fire. And I read recently, Christine, that in most charismatic churches, Pentecostal churches, up to half of the people at times don't even speak in tongues. But then those that speak in tongues only speak for a little while. It's sort of like the charismatic and Pentecostal churches are as seeker sensitive as the seeker sensitive churches. And there's got to be something more. There's got to be a whole change.
Yes.
And I believe the reason that God spared your life supernaturally, and he did, Mishpucha, and this was before she even knew him.
Yes.
So how much more after you know him is he going to protect you? Tell us what this baptism in fire is.
The baptism of the Holy Spirit and the Holy Fire is not something new. If you read the revival, there are men and women of God who had this baptism of the Holy Spirit and the baptism of the Holy Fire. This baptism of the Holy Fire is the power of God which comes from on high. Jesus Christ is the one who baptized with the Holy Spirit and with the Holy Fire. And this baptism is for everyone who desire a deep walk with God. You people of God, go deep. Go deep. Seek God. Don't give him just 5 minutes. Seek God day and night, and this baptism will be for you. If you read the book of Acts, seed, in chapter 1, you will find that the disciples had one thing in common. They devoted themselves to prayer. And in the book of Acts, chapter 2, all of a sudden, when they were in the upper room, after giving their lives to prayer, the Bible says that the wind, the shaking wind came from heaven, and the tongues of fire came. And you see what followed? After the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the fire, we see miracle left and right.
Give me one example. We see this in the book of Acts. I understand. But you have had the baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire, and that and fire, most Christians don't even understand. But It's all been watered down here in America.
Yes.
Tell me one specific person you've prayed for, someone with cancer, perhaps,
yes,
that was healed.
Yeah, I had a lady who called me on the phone, and she told me her arm was swollen. I don't know if it was cancer, but I prayed for her, and I know that when we pray, it's going to happen, because we are commanded to heal the sick. Only believe, even the people who have sickness now. Let me tell you, only believe. There is an order from heaven for you to be healed. There is a blessing coming from heaven. God is blessing you with divine health. In Jesus' name, receive your healing. Walk away from the bed of sickness and disease. In Jesus' name, only one thing you need to do, believe. God has given a command to heal you. Those who have back pain, in Jesus' name, receive your healing. Receive your healing. Believe, because there is a command, an order coming from heaven for you to be healed now in Jesus' name. Yes, when I was praying with this lady, her hand, which was swollen, shrunk back to normal size. She screamed. She said, "I have never seen anything like this." And when I prayed, I knew she was going to be healed. All the people I prayed for after the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the fire, Christ, his son, he was the only begotten son. This is a sign that shows you, people of God, hey, wake up, believe, because God loves you. He gave you the begotten son. There is nothing God will refuse for you. He gave an order for you to be healed in Jesus' name.
Mishbucha, you can tell Christine is on fire for Jesus. And Christine, does someone have to go through the horrible things you went through, the Holocaust in Rwanda? Do they have to go through that in order to be open to receive this fire, or is there a better way?
No, you don't have to go through the Holocaust to receive the fire. No, you don't have to. Because Jesus already paid the price. Yes, you will have to seek God, and at times there will be trials and testing, and you have to persevere. When you have endured to the end, the fire is going to come, but you don't have to pay any money. You don't have to pay any going through the Holocaust to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the fire.
Listen, here's what I get from your book. It puts a passion and a
yes,
hunger inside of you. And somehow, it's almost like we in the West, God has to shake us
yes,
to come to our senses. And that is coming, by the way.
It's coming.
However, wouldn't it be wonderful if someone received the baptism of fire before that happened?
Yes.
And I have to believe that there are people listening to us right now that just have lost their first love.
Yes.
There are people listening to us right now that don't even relate to what we're talking about, this baptism and fire. But if you read the book of Acts, like Christina was saying, that's normal. What we're experiencing is abnormal. You know what I think, Christine? What you're describing is what is normal.
It's normal.
And
it's
the other, what's the other then, if this is normal?
I don't understand it either, but the baptism of the Holy Spirit is for everyone, because God wants us all to be powerful to represent the kingdom of
God.
But
I can go into a church, a charismatic or a Pentecostal church, half of them will be speaking in tongues, Half of them haven't even been baptized in the Holy Spirit. And the ones that aren't baptized in the Holy Spirit, they don't move in the gifts of the Spirit to a high degree or a high magnitude. In other words, normal is the book of Acts. Anything short of that is abnormal. What kind of reports are you getting? I know it's a brand new book, but what kind of reports are you getting from people that are reading your brand new book, The Blazing Holy Fire?
Yes, we are receiving email for the people who are receiving a new fresh fire again. The people who lost their first love, they say, wow, we are getting back our first love. And the people who didn't have a hunger and a thirst, they are receiving it again, because the book is like salt. When you read it, you catch again the hunger and the thirst for God. Because before the fire, you've got to be hungry and you've got to be thirst for God.
Well, I happen to believe it's not an accident that you are listening to our discussion right now. You've recognized there's something missing. You've recognized there's a deficiency of what is available. You know, Christine, if there wasn't even healing, just to have this intimacy with God, the heart to desire God more than anything else, this is a catalyst for you. Now, if it's not an accident, you're listening. If you've been praying, God, I know there must be something more. You're hearing this discussion. This is a woman that has gone through a Holocaust, the Rwanda Holocaust. 1 million people were brutally murdered in a three-month period. And she didn't even know God, but God spared her life. And I happen to believe, Christine, it's to equip other people to have that same type of experience with God that you've had. So the name of the book, The Blazing Holy Fire, we're making it available for a donation of $18. If you have felt, I need more passion, I need more compassion, I need greater intimacy with God, I need what those first believers had, donation of $18, order today, The Blazing Holy Fire.
If you would like to receive a complimentary copy of our bi-monthly teaching newsletter, materials catalog, or information about becoming Mishpucha or Chalitzim, write to me, Sid Roth, Post Office Box 1918, Brunswick, Georgia, 31521, or call our order-only line, 1-800-548-1918. To place a credit card order, call anytime, 1-800-548-1918. For all other calls, the number is 912-265-2500. That's 912-265-2500.
For a cassette tape or CD of this week's broadcast,
send a donation of $10 or more to Sid Roth, that's S-I-D-R-O-T-H, Post Office Box 1918, Brunswick, Georgia, 31521. To see our television show, It's Supernatural,
or archives of our radio and TV shows,
look us up on the web at www.sidroth.org. That's www.sidroth.org.
Shalom, Mishpucha. Shalom, family. Mishpucha, it's a Hebrew word. It means family. And we're the Mishpucha, the family with the Jewish heart, made up of Jewish and non-Jewish people. The middle wall of separation has come down, and the two, Jew and Gentile, have become one new man in Yeshua, in Jesus. Getting ready, Mishpucha, to blow the grandest shofar. Oh, the grandest trumpet in Zion. We want everyone everywhere to hear the good news. We want everyone everywhere to be red hot for the Messiah. My guest is red hot for the Messiah, Christine Wizera. She's a survivor of the Rwanda Holocaust, where in a three-month period, 1 million people were massacred, were murdered in the most brutal fashion. And she was raised in a family, and it's Catholic tradition, but she didn't know God. She read the Bible, but she didn't know God. But God spared her life over and over and over again. And then she received not just the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but the baptism of the Holy Spirit in fire. And this is a missing ingredient in most Christians in the West. We don't even know what it is. We know what the Word says, but we don't know what it is. And she says that this can be experienced 24/7. And when you read Christine about in the book of Acts,
yes,
about where it quotes Joel, about your young children and your old men will have dreams,
yes,
and visions, you're experiencing this. Tell me a few of the things you're experiencing.
From the time I gave my life to Jesus Christ, there are times where I have dreams or vision. I cannot control those. I don't know where they are coming. But there are a few I would like to talk about, supernatural experiences or dreams and vision. One of them was a few days before September 11. We were in a Bible study and the Holy Spirit was present. We were very faithful, seeking God and praying. And in the group when we were there, I saw the word Taliban. And I wrote it down. I asked my friends if they knew. We didn't. So we look in a dictionary. We didn't understand it very well, but we prayed. So I went home 2 days
after. So you're telling me you didn't even know what the word meant, Taliban.
No, I didn't know what it was. And so we thought maybe it's a country. We look at now a country. They try to explain it's an Islamic group, but we don't get it. And so we thought also it was a book of Muslim. That's how I thought. And so when I get home, 2 days after I'm sleeping, but I have this dream. I know they are from God. I saw planes flying over a city which I didn't know. And they were cutting the heads of people. They were cutting the heads of buildings. I didn't understand the dream and this vision, and so I prayed. I said, God, whatever it is, I'm asking you that you save the soul, that you will be there for those people. I saw crying because...
So you saw the buildings, the airplanes going into the buildings?
Yes, yes.
And just cutting them? And,
yes, yes.
And you heard the name Taliban?
Yes.
And tell me some other dreams and visions that you've had.
I have also, before the tsunami.
Yes.
Before tsunami comes, I had a visitation of three angels in 1 week. I talk about that in the book a little bit. That I saw the angel, and when he went into the water were troubled, and I saw much devastation going on in Asia. I didn't again understand what it was. All I did was to pray that God will prepare the hearts of people, and if possible, He will remove this disaster away. And a week after, it happened.
What about that night you prayed all night and you had a vision of a husband?
Yes, one night I was praying from 6 p.m. I'm on my knees, and when I was praying, the spirit of intercession came over me. I could not stop. I could not tell time anymore. And in the middle of my vision, I saw who was going to be my husband and the family that God was giving us. And God said, I'm blessing you with this family because for a long time you have endured many things, and I'm going to bring you a helper. And when I look at my clock, it was 6 a.m. And remember, I had started praying at 6 p.m., so I didn't even realize how the time went by so quick.
Now, had you ever seen this man before that you had in your dream?
Yes.
Or vision, I mean?
Yes, we went to the college together, and when I saw him the first time, I asked God, I like that man, and he was a Christian. I led him to Christ, but it had been many years, like over 5 years, since we have even been in touch or talk about getting married or anything. And very soon he contacted me, and we started talking, and now we are married.
Now, wait a second. He contacted you, and you didn't contact him?
I didn't contact him. He contacted me.
And so did you immediately say, I just had a vision that we're supposed to be married?
No, because
you're too smart.
I didn't want to show him, you know, this is what's going to happen, because always I want the things, the prophecy of God to fulfill themselves. If God wants me to do something, yes. But because I knew it was from God, I didn't feel pushed to do anything because I knew it was going to happen.
Christine, there are people that have been listening to us all this week, and they have a dream once in a great while that is from God.
Yes.
They pray for people, and once in a great while, someone is healed. They experience the presence of God, but not all the time. Someone's neck was just healed, and mm-hmm. someone's hip was just healed. But they know there's more.
Mm-hmm.
Why aren't they receiving more?
Yes, they need the baptism of the Holy Fire, the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the Holy Fire, as I said, and they keep seeking. You have to seek God every day. You can't say, I have sought God a week ago. No, the price has to be paid every day, and it is so until we go to our heavenly home. The fire has to be running and burning every single day, and you find it in the Bible that they had the fire burning every single day. The fire is never to go out.
I believe that when people read your new book, The Blazing Holy Fire, that there's an anointing on it.
Yes.
For even though, see, there are people listening to us that say, yeah, I'd like to do that, but my flesh isn't letting me do it.
Yes.
I believe when they read your book, they're going to develop a passion for more of God.
Yes, I have had email coming from all over. The people saying, who are you? Who are you? This is happening to us. But I'm not surprised, because when I wrote that book, I was on my knees, and God told me, anything that is born out of prayer, it's going to touch nations, family, it's going to touch the world. So this is what the book is going to do, because I wrote it on my knees. I was seeking God.
But you told me you also had a dream that this was God's time for those that were seeking him to be baptized in the Holy Spirit and fire. You saw angels? Tell me about that again.
I saw the angels of God pulling the fire all over the earth, because this is the time that Jesus is about to come. He wants a bride that is ready, that is purified. And how can you be purified if you don't go through the fire? We have to go through the fire in order for us to carry this message of God, in order to carry his power. Only a vessel that is broken, holy, pure, is going to carry the fire of God and his power. And it will happen through the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the holy fire.
Have you had any dreams or visions about the return of the Messiah?
I have had the dreams, and I don't understand them very well, but it's sooner than many people realize. It's sooner. And you people of God, we must work hard. We must be ready. We must preach the gospel, because the Bible says this gospel must be preached to the nations. We don't know the hour or the time, but we can tell by looking at the season that the time is very, very near, at the door, at the threshold.
You even have dreams and visions about people, and then you minister to them. For instance, tell me about that lady that was going to commit suicide.
Yes, I was working in a place. There was a friend who was going to commit suicide, but when I saw her, I prayed, and then the Lord gave me the vision of what she was going through, and I invited her over my house, and when she comes, I tell her, this is what you are trying to do, but God wants to tell you he's not forgotten you. And there are so many Christians out there, you think God has forgotten you. God tells you right now, no, I didn't forget you. Dream again. Dream. Come to me. I didn't forget you. You are mine. I call you by name. I know you. I love you. So God loves you. Don't do that. Don't think that God doesn't love you, because he loves you, and he will love you to the very end.
Okay, Mishpocha, consider yourself challenged. I believe that some of you that are backslidden, some of you that are lukewarm, some of you that are just plain religious, when you start reading this book and you see the supernatural protection of Christine during the Rwanda Holocaust, a time in which 1 million people were brutally murdered in a 3-month period, and how she was supernaturally spared. And that's before she even knew Jesus.
Yes.
Imagine how much more, now that she knows Jesus, will she walk in supernatural protection based on the vision she's seen about what's coming to the United States. But even more than that, it's a fascinating story that will equip you for what's coming. It will make you hungry for more of God. Christine, we can have this.
Yes.
It's for everyone.
It's a wars. It's a wars all along. God wants us to walk in His power.
Okay, Mishpucha. The book is called The Blazing Holy Fire. And as you read this book, what you've read in Scripture will start becoming real to you, because it's going to light a fire. You're going to become so hungry for the things of God. I believe it's not an accident you're listening to this broadcast right now. I urge you to get this book. It's called The Blazing Holy Fire. We're making it available for a donation of $18. And Christine, on tomorrow's broadcast, and I'd like people to pray about this, people need a jump start, so to speak. They need to receive this fire. And then when they read the book, they'll be able to move even faster, making it available for a donation of $18, The Blazing Holy Fire.
If you would like to receive a complimentary copy of our bi-monthly teaching newsletter, materials catalog, or information about becoming Mishpucha or Chalitzim, write to me, Sid Roth, Post Office Box 1918, Brunswick, Georgia, 31521, or call our order-only line, 1-800-548-1918. To place a credit card order, call anytime, 1-800-548-1918. For all other calls, the number is 912-265-2500. That's 912-265-2500.
For a cassette tape or CD of this week's broadcast,
send a donation of $10 or more to Sid Roth, that's SIDROTH, Post Office Box 1918, Brunswick, Georgia, 31521. To see our television show, It's Supernatural,
or archives of our radio and TV shows,
look us up on the web at www.sidroth.org. That's www.sidroth.org.
Shalom, Mishpucha. Shalom, family. Mishpucha, it's a Hebrew word. It means family, and we're the Mishpucha, the family with a Jewish heart, made up of Jewish and non-Jewish people, where the middle wall of separation has come down to form one new man. Getting ready, Mishpucha, to blow the grandest shofar, or the grandest trumpet in Zion. We want everyone everywhere to be red hot with the fire of God. And I believe that many of you are going to have an encounter with the fire of God. My guest, Christine Wizera, is a woman that survived supernaturally, miraculously, the Rwanda Holocaust. She didn't even know Jesus. She knew about him, but she did not know him. And then when she eventually came back to her own country, Rwanda, a revival had broken out. And the minute her foot touched the soil, the power of God was so strong, she started shaking. And then she eventually got born again, filled with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And she says this is normal. Book of Acts Christianity is normal. What we're experiencing here in the West is abnormal. It's just plain religion. If you felt there's something more, there is. Christine, what's it like to be baptized with the Holy Spirit and fire?
Oh, it's a wonderful, it's a glorious journey. No more fear. You have the fear of God, but you have nothing else to fear. You receive boldness, and you know who you are, and you walk having a kingdom mentality, knowing who you are, and knowing how powerful is your God, and you know how small the devil is. So no fear.
In other words, you become more heavenly aware, more
yes.
of an ambassador for heaven than an ambassador for earth.
Yes.
You become a kingdom person.
Yes.
And you're like, you know, some people, they go their whole life and they say, well, I said my little prayer, I'm going to go to heaven, but they miss having the impact that God has created them to have. Would you pray for people? If you're hungering and thirsting for more, Christina wrote a book called The Blazing Holy Fire that'll put a passion and a fire within you to want more, to be hungrier for God than you've ever been in your life. Christina, there are many people that are so hungry for God right
yes.
now. Would you pray for them?
Yes, yes. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I bring before you my brothers and my sister who have lost their first love. Father, I bring those who are in most trying time and they are losing hope. I bring those who are lukewarm. Your word says that the lukewarm, you will spit out of your mouth. But Father, I know you are a merciful God. I know you are a God of power and love. I'm asking you in Jesus' name, Father, reach out your hand and touch them, O God. One touch from heaven. Let it change your life. In Jesus' name, come out. Father, in Jesus' name, I'm asking you to release a hunger, a thirst in every soul that they will hunger for you and they will seek you as the deer seeks the water. In Jesus' name, I speak to you. People of God, come to Him. Come to His table. It is ready. Oh, everyone who is thirsty, come. Receive the hunger. Receive from heaven. Receive the heavenly fire. Seek God. Seek God. Get back to your prayer closet and receive the fire from heaven, because you need it, because you need that passion, you need that first love. In Jesus' name, Father, I thank you that you have touched your people, that you have shaken your people, and that you're giving them that new power, the Holy Spirit, and the holy fire. In Jesus' name, amen.
You know, Christine, I believe that many people are being touched, and you are walking in this fire 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
That's
normal. And most of you are walking in religion. I mean, choose which one you want, religion or normal, intimacy or religion, peace or religion. I mean, to me, it's a no contest. And why now? Why is this book coming out right now? Why didn't it come out a couple years ago, Christine?
It's the timing of the Lord, because He's putting out the fire and He wants people to receive from heaven. It's coming. Powerful, mighty revival. It's coming. But only those who have this fire will take the power of God.
There are people listening to us right now
yes.
that are sick in
yes.
their body. Tell me about one person, just pull one person that you prayed for that God healed. Tell me about that one person.
There are so many, but there is this one lady. I walked by her, and I knew that she has back pain because I felt it in my spirit. I stopped her. She was not even a believer. I say, excuse me, we are in a marketplace. Excuse me, do you have back pain? She said, how do you know? I said, in Jesus' name, you arise, you be healed. And she received her healing like that.
Now, do you do this often? You're just walking in
everywhere
the street,
I go,
in an airport?
Safeway, King Super, wherever I go shopping, I do it. And I go to hospital also.
Okay, there are people listening that are hurting in their bodies. There are people listening that have cancer. There are people listening that have high blood pressure. There are people listening that have heart trouble. There are people listening that have tumors throughout their body. There are people listening that have insomnia. There are people listening that have AIDS. There's people listening with, they have terminal disease. There are people listening that need new body parts. I want you to pray for these people now.
You people who have any sickness in your body, I want you to know that God loves you and God is ready now to do a complete healing in you. Have faith in God. Believe His word. Believe, only believe. That's what He is asking you. We are going to pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you that your power is coming down. I thank you that the heavens are open to touch those who have those incurable disease, to touch those even who have simple sickness that we know, Lord Father God, in Jesus' name, by the stripes of Jesus Christ. You have been made whole. You have been healed. Receive your healing. Receive your healing. Walk away from that sickness. Walk away from that bed of sickness as you walk away from another place. Just walk away from that sickness in Jesus' name. The hand of God is over you to heal you from AIDS, from back pain, from headaches, from all kinds of cancer. Be healed in Jesus' name. It is written in His word. You receive it, and you know His word is a quick sword that is mighty to save you, that is mighty to deliver you from all evil. Sickness is evil, and the Lord has come to set you free from all evil. In Jesus' name, I know you have received it. In Jesus' name, I know there is a new beginning for you. God bless you. Receive your new healing and walk a new life to never be the same again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Christine, there is like a river that is pouring out. It's been pouring out all this week. It's pouring out right now. And I read in Ezekiel about the river. And where it says in Ezekiel 47, wherever the river goes, there is healing.
Yes.
And so there's a healing river that is flowing out.
Jump in.
It's, wouldn't it be neat, Mishpucha, to picture a real hot day? It's so hot. And there is a refreshing river that is flowing from heaven. It's not a normal river. It's not filled with pollution. It's filled with life. And whatever touches that river, wherever the water goes, there is life. And you can now jump in. That's what Christine said, and I'm just making a picture for you, framing a picture for you. Jump into that healing river right now. I mean, there are things that you need to be healed of, pains and diseases, but there's things even emotionally you have to be healed of. Just jump. Oh, there it goes.
Yes,
there's just a gusher.
There's
a gusher. Just jump right into that river. Christine, I believe that when people read your brand new book, it is a brand new book, it's called The Blazing Holy Fire, they're going to find out how God miraculously spared your life time and time again when you didn't even know Him and you were involved in something. It's almost beyond belief, a million people slaughtered in a three-month period in Rwanda. But you've seen bombs coming on numerous occasions. You've seen war in this country.
Yes.
I don't see how people are going to be able to survive without the fire of God.
That's why God is sending those books to prepare the heart of His people, so that when these things happen, they are ready for it.
You know, Mishpucha, many of you have experienced the presence of God for a moment, but it's not supposed to be for a moment. It's supposed to be 24/7. I believe it's not an accident that you have tuned into our broadcast this week. And this book, it's a brand new book. We're making it available to you. It's called The Blazing Holy Fire. It's available for a donation of $18. This is the Shabbat broadcast. Let me pray over you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause His countenance to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord grant you his shalom, his completeness, in your spirit, in your soul, and in your body. In the name of the Sar Shalom, the Prince of Peace, Yeshua HaMashiach Tzidkenu, Jesus the Messiah, our righteousness.
Yivarechech Adonai ve'yishmarech. Ya'er Adonai panav eilech v'chonech. Yisa Adonai panav eilech. Ve'asem lecha shalom.
If you would like to receive a complimentary copy of our bi-monthly teaching newsletter, materials catalog, or information about becoming Mishpucha or Chalitzim, write to me, Sid Roth, Post Office Box 1918, Brunswick, Georgia, 31521, or call our order-only line, 1-800-548-1918. To place a credit card order, call anytime, 1-800-548-1918. For all other calls, the number is 912-265-2500. That's 912-265-2500. 2500.
For a cassette tape or CD of this week's broadcast,
send a donation of $10 or more to Sid Roth, that's SIDROTH, Post Office Box 1918, Brunswick, Georgia, 31521. To see our television show, It's Supernatural,
or archives of our radio and TV shows,
look us up on the web at www.sidroth.org. That's www.sidroth.org.